I actually have a new nickname now for Vince, which is Professor, so which is good. Tells you, though, how close Vince and I actually have become over the past couple of years, because I'm actually a Carolina fan. And after last year, I sat there, I said, I'm never going to go to Villanova. But when Vince asked, the answer was, of course, yes. I must tell you, you have somebody of high integrity as your professor, and I've really had great joy and quite a privilege having worked with him over the past couple of years. So, well, who am I? I'm the Senior Vice President of Properties at the Wasserman Media Group. I started almost 25 years ago in this business in London, in production. What I wanted to do when I graduated, shows you how your life can take different routes, was actually be on air. And back then, I actually was better looking and didn't just have a face for radio, but it was difficult to break into the business. I went to Northwestern, which, as you know, has a phenomenal journalism school, and I wanted to do play-by-play. So my tapes were much more about play-by-play than they were about doing news reports or sports reports. So ultimately, after trying to find a job for 6 months and being a finalist for many, I ended up moving to London to work for a company called IMG. Many of you, I'm sure, have heard about them. And this was back in the heyday when Mr. McCormack was the owner of the company, and he basically, as I'm sure many of you know, is the founder of sports marketing. So I was very lucky to be at IMG for 9.5 years, where I moved from production in London onto the content side, where I worked for Barry Frank, who is still at IMG and is about 86, 87 now, and is probably one of the most well-known agents that has ever existed in this business. I also work for Sean McManus, who is now the president, actually chairman, of CBS Sports. So within about a year and a half, my heart was broken when Sean left and went to CBS. I stayed at the company and then was asked by Mark and his son Todd to help launch our interactive business, which we were going to spin off and make public. And it was a little bit dicey trying to do it back then, because digital isn't, or wasn't then, what it is today. Very, very different. We were ahead of our time in some respects. But I could see that things weren't going in the direction that I wanted them to go into, and ultimately started looking for other opportunities and ended up at ABC Sports. So I was involved in programming at ABC Sports, and my boss, Lauren Matthews, who was one of the first 100 employees at ESPN, decided, because of my background and where I thought we should take looking at profit and loss when we were doing deals, Lauren put me in charge, in essence, of all of our acquisitions. And where I started to make a mark, and I think even George Bodenheimer would tell you this if he was sitting here, former president of ESPN, was I didn't like how we were looking at content. I thought we were going to lose rights if we didn't look at it corporately. So here I am, my early 30s, and we're having a negotiation for the rights to the Atlantic Coast Conference. And our P&L for ABC Sports was showing a $30 million loss. And we had a conference call with the CFO for ABC, Jim Hedges, and Jim said, we're not doing this deal. And I said, Jim, we have to do this deal. I need you to give me a week so I can show you that if we lose the ACC on ABC, the domino effects that this will have on everything we do in college sports across ABC and ESPN. He thinks I'm nuts. I probably was. But I knew that we would be in jeopardy across the two companies if we lost this content. So I reached out to a friend of mine on the sales side, who's now their SVP of sales and marketing, Rob Temple. I said, Rob, here's what I'm trying to do. I need a little bit of help. So we started to look at the numbers, started to see how the impact would take place on ESPN, not just on ABC. And word starts to spread. Who is this guy? What's he doing? This is great. Thank goodness somebody's doing it. Finance finds out about it. Who's this little peon who's only been here a year and a half? What's he doing here? And we explained. And it gets to George. And George says, let's finish the process and see what comes up. We put together this deck that showed the ramifications of what would happen if ABC Sports lost the ACC and how it would have an impact on other areas of our business. To make a long story short, the ABC CFO was overruled. We retained the ACC. And every P&L that we did from that point on looked at rights, if it was a joint deal, both ABC and ESPN. Completely changed the paradigm. Hadn't been done before, they still do it today. So in 2005, if I remember correctly, 5-6, ESPN takes over ABC Sports. I was fortunate enough to be asked to stay, so I did, and stayed in programming for another 3 years, I guess, and then was asked to move to Bristol, or Ed Earhart, who's the president of the sales group, wanted to have me in a role that they were going to create specific for me, which was, in essence, a business affairs role looking at all acquisitions across the company, whether it was a property or a business. Because Ed's belief was I was the only one who really took sales into consideration when we were doing P&Ls, and he wanted that to continue. So that's what we did, and a couple of years later, Dean Jordan, who is the managing director of the group that I work with, within, called for the second time because he tried to get me in 2007 to go work for him and said, this time you don't have to move to Raleigh, you can stay in New York, are you interested? And I was at a crossroads that all of you are going to face at different times in your career. Do I make the move or do I stay? Because at the time, ESPN was going through more changes and they were giving me more responsibility, but I made the decision that if I wasn't going to leave at that point, I may never leave. And as much as I love ESPN and the people who are there, I didn't want to just know about ESPN. I wanted to know about the business and how everything else could be impacted, and not just by a decision that we were making at Disney, but what were other companies doing? What were schools doing? What were conferences doing? Where was media going? So I took the leap. I've been at Wasserman for now over 6 years. And during that time, when I first got there, the small group that we had was doing about $1 million worth of business, and my group now is doing about $2.5 million, and the properties team itself is probably doing about $6.5-7 million. So we grew the business, and part of that was because I said we can't just be trying to negotiate media rights for college conferences. We have to look at technologies, other things that are going to impact sports and entertainment. We should be out in front of that and talking to these people. So we did, and we have. A really good example of that is last year we were working with Amazon as they were trying to figure out their sports strategy. That wasn't the case a couple of years before. Quite frankly, a couple of years before, Amazon wasn't what it is today. So I've been very, very lucky, and I recognize that. I've been to more sporting events than I ever could have imagined. I've been on the field for different games that people would kill to experience. One of my biggest conundrums, quite frankly, took place at the Texas-USC Rose Bowl. Because here I am on the field, overseeing the programming for ABC Sports. Matt Leinart's throw, incomplete, confetti goes everywhere, game's over, and I'm starting to walk back to the production truck. That's the game ball. Yeah, I can't take that. I'm here to work. The one thing that this business teaches you is that it's a business. Yes, you can be a fan, but at the end of the day, it's a business. We're blessed that we're not building widgets, but the joke is I've actually built widgets because that's what applications used to be called. We're widgets. So yes, I feel very, very lucky. I think my bucket list for the most part, it certainly in the US, has been checked off. But it is a very, very difficult business, and it is changing. What once seemed to be a simple definition for something, and I'm sure you're going through that now in this course, has changed dramatically, and we'll talk a little bit about that when we get into the presentation. But for any of you who want to get into sports, it's a business. You have to work really hard. You're lucky, of course, to be able to go to certain events. But it's always funny when people say, oh, you're going to San Francisco for a meeting. Yeah, I'm going to be in a hotel. I'll be in a negotiation for 48 straight hours. Not going to see anything. That's what I'm going to be doing. Yes, there are great spoils to it, but it is a business, and you really, really have to work hard. I had a kid from a school, I won't name which school to protect the innocent, but he said to me, and this is an undergrad, a couple of years ago, we had done some work with that particular school, and he said, you know, I really want to get into this business. I said, well, what do you want to be? He said, I'd like to be an agent. I said, really? I said, why? Because I want to be like Ari from Entourage. I said to him, I said, Parker, you know I like you, but if you ever say that in an interview, you're not going to get the job. Why do you want to be in sports? Because I love sports. You're not going to get the job. You've got to find out other reasons as to why you want to be in it. What impact can you have on the business? And that's what I feel fortunate enough to have been able to do in certain cases. But at the end of the day, as much as I work for Wasserman, I work for my clients. A couple of years ago when I was working with Vince, I was working for Vince. Yes, the business card said Wasserman, but everything that I did was about him and that project. It has to be. Because that's how you get business. That's how it recurs. And for me, I believe that business is never personal, but you make it personal. I want to know about that other person. I want to know about their husband, their wife, their sons, their daughters. What do they like to do? Because at the end of the day, that contract that you sign after negotiating it for years, and in a couple of cases with ESPN, it does take a couple of years. That contract goes in the drawer, and then it's based on the relationship. And you only have to pull it out when you really can't figure out how to resolve an issue. And I've been fortunate because in the 25 years I've been doing this, yes, I've had disputes, but nothing that has ever risen to the level that would ruin a relationship or meant that we weren't going to retain a property or acquire a property. I've been cursed out by commissioners. I've been yelled at by their underlings. There's always going to be periods of tough times and rough times. How you handle it will define you more than anything else. And the reason why I bring that up is because this business is a small business. And everything you do is looked upon. And when you make mistakes, they're magnified, particularly because of what it is. It's sports, it gets played out in public. So, like I said, I've been very, very fortunate. I think you have a really good guy as your professor. And the most important thing is how you conduct yourself. Because ultimately that is how people are going to hire you, how they're going to continue to work with you and for you. When I get a text, hey, thanks for the meeting, from somebody I just met, you're not going to get much help, more help from me. I want somebody to write me a letter. The chairman of our company, Casey Wasserman, as you know, is the co-chair of the LA Olympic bid. Casey, his grandfather, was the founder of Universal Studios. And Casey could sit there and say, you know what? I don't have to work a day in my life. But instead, he built one of the leading sports marketing and entertainment companies in the world. When I first showed up at Wasserman on my very first day, there was a personal handwritten note from Casey welcoming me to Wasserman. Wow. He took the time, I think we had about 450 employees, but he took the time to welcome me with something personal. If you're in a job interview and you're writing a thank you note, maybe make it handwritten or send it in post, not necessarily an email. Those things matter. It starts to define who you are and it separates who you are from the others who aren't doing that. And please, please, please spell correctly. The one thing that texting does is kind of covers that up sometimes, and no emojis. But anyway, so let me get into a little bit about who Wasserman is and see if this thing can actually work as we move this down. So like I said, we are about 650, 700 employees around the world right now. There are three core areas where we focus. One is on brands. And we'll talk a little bit about that in the next slide, next two slides. Properties, which is where my group is. So what do? We represent the rights, the media rights, not just TV rights, everything's now media, to a variety of different sports organizations, leagues, governing bodies all around the world. And the third is talent. We represent over 3,000 athletes. So a couple of bigger names that I'm sure you're familiar with, Andrew Luck, Anthony Davis, just to name a few. We have two of the top four golfers in the world right now as well. Our footprint is global, with offices all around the world. Casey's very careful about where he expands, because he doesn't want to just go into an area without having more of a vision and a direction, and quite frankly, a partnership. So generally, he's looking to acquire companies internationally to help build our footprint. So who do we work for and who do we work with? On the brand side, we've represented over 80 clients, negotiating over $700 million in sponsorship. Since I got to Wasserman, my group, the Properties Group, has negotiated over $20 billion in media rights over the past 5.5 years. That's something we're very, very proud of. I'll point out a couple of the bigger ones. I'm not, where's Microsoft? Microsoft might not even be on this slide. But Microsoft, you see those Surface tablets that are on the sideline of the NFL? That's us. We're the ones working with the NFL helping to negotiate that. As a result, we're also working with broadcast partners to figure out how to get those tablets integrated in their programs. So when you see Trey Wingo holding one of those tablets when he's talking about the NFL on NFL Live, that's us. helping to get that done. So you can see it's a pretty good cross-section, and not all of it ends up in sports. Some of it with Universal was about Minions. We were involved with Minions. The New York City Ballet, how do they grow their business? And no, I am not going to do any type of barre or anything like that. I had nothing to do with that one. But you can see that it is really a who's who of brands all across the world. So my group, the Properties Group, Global Media, like I said, the core is negotiating media rights. But beyond that, it's also figuring out what your strategy should be. If you're a potential owner of a team, you might hire us to help you figure out how to acquire that team. And we've done that twice since I've been there. One with the LA Dodgers. Stephen Cohen was our client. And for those of you who watch some cable, you know the show Billions, and that's loosely based on Stephen. But also, as there was a potential for a hockey franchise to be in Seattle, we were working with them as well. So there are various areas where we can work with teams, leagues, governing bodies. But we also do a lot of social media work. And this one is really interesting, nerve visual search technology. I'm sure you've heard of RepuCom, who tries to evaluate how much exposure a sponsor receives on TV. Generally, how that's done by other companies is they have somebody sitting in front of a TV monitor. Okay, so that logo is up for 5 seconds. Now it's up for 10 seconds. Okay, now I got to figure out what the value of that exposure is. And I'm going to discount it because it's not a commercial, but I'll use a 30-second commercial rate. Not exactly the most efficient way to do it. Whereas with Nerve, this technology came out of the military. It's about pixelation. So it is literally taking the pixelation from your TV screen or your digital screen, and that's how it's pulling down how much exposure a logo is actually receiving or a commercial receives. And then we put our own special sauce to spit it out. So it's a lot more accurate. 13 NBA teams last year hired us to evaluate what the jersey patch that they're going to start having on their uniforms in 17, 18. That's us. We work for two players' associations. I won't confirm or deny whether we were involved in some way, shape, or form with the CBA discussions that took place with the NBA and the NBPA. So we have quite a cross-section of what we're able to do and who we're able to work with. But it includes everybody. It doesn't matter whether it is a professional team, whether it is a college, whether it is a conference, or whether it is Amazon or Twitter. They're hiring us to try to help them figure out what they should be doing, because everybody has two goals: extending reach and revenue. And that's what we're here to try to help them to do. So let's talk a little bit about the evolution of media, how distribution has changed, and how sponsorship continues to evolve, because that, I think, is some of what Vince has said you guys have started to talk about. So I'm going to try to run through this, because hopefully you have a lot of questions at the end. So then, I wasn't born at this point, so that none of this is me or my family. But you had one TV, maybe two, in the 50s. And I can assure you that there was such a thing called a black and white television. And that's what people were watching, was a black and white TV. And you really only had a couple of networks. There was no such thing as a remote control. I still remember having to get up and turn a knob. Today, this is what a media company now looks like. So not only do they have their broadcast, their cable, they also have some local assets. They have a whole bunch of digital that they own. If you're Disney or Universal, you've got the theme parks, whole bunch of international, and then there's some lifestyle stuff that's included in it. But that's starting to change. Because in February, as many of you might have read, because of the consolidation of what's taking place with some of these networks that are not doing very well, you see the Disneys, the Comcasts, saying we're not going to have as many networks. Viacom, we need to cut it down. Because right now, we're losing cable penetration. And we'll start talking about that in a little bit. But Esquire, not going to be around. So there's a much more seriously strict focus on where these businesses should go and what businesses they should be in. Big Ten rights were up last year, 15-16. NBC took a sniff, but they were getting out of the college business. They got out of the college business, really, other than NBC's deal with Notre Dame and an existing deal that they have with the Atlantic 10 and a little bit else. They're sticking to their core. You've noticed that ESPN has said, well, you know what? We don't have to have everything. When I was there, we had everything. Now, we don't. They don't. Still say we. Over that time, and what continues to be an absolute, is that sports delivers. So while all of the change has been taking place over the past few decades, what has also changed is the value of sports. It is still 95% TiVo proof. People want to watch it live. Still. But the number of top programs now have also gone higher that are more related to sports as opposed to the Seinfelds of the world. Back then, 14%, now over 93%. But at some point, the question is, are we going to hit a level where those rights fees are going to continue to go up? Or are they going to start to level off? Or are they going to start to go down? And in some cases, it's already taking place. And we'll talk a little bit about that, too. So as sports continues to become more and more valuable, especially the best product, where it ends up is changing. When I grew up, it was the TV. Now, if you're the NFL, not only do you have more than just the game itself, you have all this surround content, all this additional programming, and you can see it on multiple devices and in multiple places. Because what the best leagues are trying to do is carve up as many packages as they can. And they hold out rights, just like they did to allow Twitter last year to get the rights to the NFL. You would think that NBC, CBS, Verizon would say, you know what? We own those rights. No chance. Can't do a deal with Twitter and get it over a mobile device. And no. The NFL is really smart about how they try to carve up their content to reach as many people as they can and drive as much revenue as possible. And what's interesting about it is it's now taking place in the sponsorship arena too. A few years ago, in the insurance category, it was State Farm. That's your insurance category. Today, that in category has been split between USAA and Nationwide. And they try to figure out how to change the definition so that they can split the categories. And then the assets that get delivered also change. The car category used to just be GMC. Now that's changed. Now you've got a truck as well as a car. You can get a luxury car. They continue to slice the definition, which is critical because if you end up as lawyers in this field, those definitions continue to change and evolve, particularly as companies are acquiring other companies. So as the value of certain sports content is only growing, there's not a lot on the marketplace today, and there are some great properties that are going to be coming up in the next couple of years. So you might see some bidding wars. And the biggest one that will be coming up in the immediate future, really, is going to be the PGA of America with the PGA Championship and the UFC. But as you can see, other big properties are going to be coming up, and there will be reset times when they do. And in a couple of cases, they're going to be right next door to each other. So what are those networks going to be spending their money on? And not just the networks. What about the Facebooks, the Twitters? What are they going to be doing? It's likely not going to be Snapchat. They're not interested in the live game content as much as they are just the live surround content. But are they going to enter the fray in greater ways? We shall see. But a lot of good stuff is coming up in the next few years. So a lot of key decisions have to be made. And as people are trying to make those decisions about what product they want, a lot of things they have to take into consideration. One of which is this notion of cord cutting. People who are saying, like you, I don't want my cable. I'm not as interested in cable TV. Back in 2008, my aunt's visiting my cousin, her daughter. I want to watch what's going on with the election. Can I get CNN? What channel is CNN? She said, I don't have cable. Not interested in it. This is real, and it continues to, quite frankly, for a lot of programmers, get worse. When I was at ESPN in about 2010, we were at a high of 100 million households. Today, they're in about 87 million. Now, if you do the math, let's say every ESPN package is worth $10, ESPN, ESPN2, all of that. And you've just lost 20 million subscribers a month who are paying $10 times 12 months. That's billions of dollars in revenue that they don't see. So when you read the stories about them saying, you know what, we're not going to continue with certain talent, we're not going to renew their talent, you've probably read about the upcoming layoffs that may be taking place, it's real. That's why certain networks are no longer going to exist, like Esquire, because they have to start to figure out what are they going to do and how are they going to spend their money and where, knowing that they have these issues. What's interesting is the consumption, depending upon your age group, is pretty strong. If you're over 50, you're watching a lot of TV. Still, if you're not over 50, you're not watching a lot of TV. You're on your Instagram, Snapchat. Facebook is passe, it's old. That's for me and Vince. It's not for you guys. That's at least what we hear. Candidly, I'm not on it anyway. You have people now, I think about one-third of the adults actually have Netflix accounts. So people are changing how they're consuming content and where. And what we tell our clients is what you produce for Facebook has to be different than what you produce for Twitter, has to be different than what you produce for Instagram, has to be different than what you produce for Snapchat, because it's being consumed differently. You can't just have a one-stop shop. But other considerations are, well, what's taking place in terms of the mergers and acquisitions? I talked about definitions. We're working right now with AT&T on a couple of different areas. And because they now have DirecTV, and now they're talking about Time Warner, those definitions are changing as to what rights they want, where they want to put their content. What is that sponsorship being defined by? Disney, last year, spent $1 billion to invest in BAMTech. the back-end technology for streaming that not only baseball uses, but the NHL, PGA Tour, and others. They have an option in 4 years to pick up another third for another $1 billion. This is impacting deals we are currently doing. They may not be able to tell me what the package is going to look like, how much I'm going to have to spend as a consumer, what verticals I'm going to have, but ESPN is saying, if I'm negotiating a conference deal, you need to put some content on this new platform. Well, how do I do that deal? Who's going to see it? How's it being packaged? Am I seeing any additional revenue from it? Oh, no? Oh, but you're not going to do a deal with me for that championship game that you've always done the deal with unless I put some of the regular season content on that platform. There's a lot of leverage that they have. Verizon and Yahoo clearly have been in the news most recently. Check your Yahoo accounts. Hopefully nothing's been stolen. But anyway, we've all seen what's taken place with that, and it's changing. And then Viacom and CBS, even though word is that's not going to take place anymore, it still might. But these guys are all making the same decisions. What network should we continue to push out? Which one should we consolidate? Where should we be investing our money? Because they're all feeling the pinch in one way or another. So the world continues to change. And when we negotiate these deals, we have to know what's taking place because our clients are depending upon us to know. And where we don't know, we have to tell them we're not sure, but we'll give you our best educated guess because, quite frankly, no one knows. A few years ago, nobody had heard of Snap Inc. And as many of you know, it wasn't what it is today. It was definitely being used for different purposes than it is today. Yet here they are, $33 billion or whatever that number is. So the only thing I can tell you is the evolution is going to continue. The definitions are going to change. And the best thing you can do is be as prepared as possible for when those questions are being asked. And with that, any questions from you?
Yeah, I was wondering, the splitting up of the rights. If I'm a sponsor or I'm one of these people making deals, I don't want to hear that you've split up the rights. Do you have to wait on the end of the last deal before you think of a creative way? If you're a you're going to be the GMC, and then you find out you're not the main person anymore. There's three other cars in there. Do you have to wait on the end of the GMC deal to do that, or do you go back to the definitions and say we're actually allowed to slice things up?
So it kind of goes in a couple of different ways. One is you might be shocked and say, well, wait a second, I thought I had that, and the answer is no, you didn't. But if you want it, you got to pay more for it. And that's generally what's also happening. So it's often a renegotiation of the rights that you think you might have, but maybe don't, as opposed to it being, hey, we're, you know what, we're not even going to tell you, we're just going to give it away and then come back to you, because that goes back to what I was saying before. How's that good for the relationship? You really want to be more above board than that, I believe.
There is an analogy with music production where the definition, you know, where they wrote contracts that didn't take into account new technology, and I guess you're talking about that phenomenon, where they do contracts not knowing all the platforms that are possible, so maybe they haven't given all those away?
No, basically, I mean, what we used to do at ESPN, it was called Any Pipe, Any Device. And there's that statement that says now known or hereafter developed. You try not to just have it be that much of a blanket statement now. You really try to figure out, certainly from my side, how to slice that as much as possible. And I also don't want to give up too many rights. So the ACC was a logo that I put up there. We were involved in the launch of the ACC network. So many of you probably read that the ACC is going to be starting its own linear network in a couple of years. They have it being done digitally right now. We were a part of that process. In those negotiations, ESPN said, we want certain rights beyond just the actual game rights. And one of those rights was to really control the highlights, particularly in-game highlights. And I said, no, can't do that. I remember Kevin White's sitting right here, who's the athletic director at Duke, and he's looking at me like, where's he going with this? And I said, the reason for that, ESPN, is because you can't be in a position where you're controlling every message that these schools are putting out on social media. And if they're going to drive the fan by putting something at the end of that highlight, tune into ESPN. Why is that a bad thing? You're only driving tune-in. So if somebody's not watching it because they're out of their home, but they're getting updates and being told to go here, isn't that good for you too? Yeah, see your point. So a lot of it has to do with what type of rights do you want to give up to somebody else to, in essence, control, versus what rights do you want to make sure you're maintaining for yourself? And then where's the happy medium?
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
You've probably been charging before, but it's my last one. So as the traditional linear networks decline in terms of their subscription revenues, we have these non-traditional platforms emerging, Facebook Live and Twitter, who have Amazon and others that have these Netflix, you know, have this platform to be able to distribute content. As those new rights become available, how active will the non-traditional distributors be in terms of being potential partners in that space?
I guess the question, you know, really is, how do you define non-traditional now? You know, it used to be that digital was called new media,
right,
and that term's gone away. So Amazon seems to be, if that's what you're assuming, is a non-traditional, which could be traditional going forward. Amazon here in the U.S. is in an interesting position, right? Because they are about 50% penetrated with Amazon Prime. And what they're trying to do internationally is to develop Amazon Prime. So when we were looking at the Bundesliga rights for Amazon in Germany, part of the analysis was, if they get the rights, will that drive Amazon Prime subscriptions? Because if it does, it starts to pay for itself. So there are a lot of other factors that go into it. And then it becomes a one-to-one relationship. And this is where I think the paradigm starts to fall down. This is just my opinion. Which is, if I'm going to charge you, in essence, it's pay-per-view. So can I really get to those rights fees that other party needs when I don't really know what that price point should be because I have to charge you? I could lose a lot of money. You know, we at one point when I was at ESPN, and they still do this, but you know, we're trying to figure out, okay, what would we have to sell ESPN for in order to make the same type of revenue if it ever went a la carte? And we were at like $40. And this is back in about 10 years ago. How many people in this room would spend $40 to get ESPN a month? And here's the fallacy about ESPN, while it's also its brilliance. The average rating on ESPN for a 24-hour period is less than 1% of their households. Less than 1%. Yet they're still in 87, 88 million households. They were still in 100 million households, and on average, a 24-hour day, less than 1% of the audience was actually watching. So that's where it gets a little bit dicey. Because if I'm Facebook, how am I going to charge you for watching this content? So that the bigger players, the NFLs, Major League Baseballs, are going to say, you know what? I don't need to have as many games on ESPN or Fox or CBS or NBC. Because that's really where a lot of the money comes from. You know, the brilliance of what Rupert Murdoch did back in the early 90s when he got into the NFL, which is really not talked about, is he owned 35, 36 local stations. All that revenue was going right back into Fox. So he could offer more money than everybody else because he owned more local stations. so he could put pregame shows together, postgame shows together. He was getting inventory already in the telecast. I know I didn't answer all these questions so well that you had going into this class. Go ahead.
Has there been an effort to combat account sharing, whether it's Netflix passwords or a kid our age using their parents' HBO account to use HBO Go? Like, that's obviously taking a big hit, and why a bunch of us don't have TV services because we can use our parents or things like that. So how have they been fighting that?
It's a really interesting question because people do it differently and some people don't do it at all. And I'm not sure that anybody has developed the answer yet. I think what they're trying to do right now is to suggest that you can, it's kind of like healthcare. We'll allow you to have a certain number on your plan. That's really been the answer. But I'm going to give you a different anecdote to help answer the question of how people do it differently. So, a lot of content gets thrown up on YouTube. Millions of hours of content every year. It's ridiculous. And what often used to happen when league content was going up there was that the leagues would be sending cease and desist letters to YouTube. You got to take it down. You don't have the rights to have it up. Well, we're not putting it up there. Somebody else is, another fans, but we've got nothing to do with it. And there's this back and forth. The NBA, to their credit, said it's okay. Why? Because there was something that YouTube developed called Content ID, which basically allowed them to recognize through their software what content was being viewed and sell against it, and give a revenue share against that video. The NBA said, I'd rather take something than nothing, and I'm not going to continue with the cease and desist. Let the fans put up as much as they can. So they took a totally different approach than everybody else did. They were the first. Yes?
Generally speaking,
Virtual reality is reality now, quite frankly. And there is a difference, as I think you know, between 360 and virtual reality. But it is real. If any of you have the YouTube channel on your phone, I want you to do a search under MANDT, M-A-N-D-T, V-R, Steelers, and watch that video. Now that was shot, it was also for 360. But the Steelers are giddy about this because they're saying, look at this content. I can now distribute this to my fans. This is awesome. I can charge a dollar every week and shoot something like, oh, great. I've got 500,000 fans who are, oh, I just made $500,000. And other teams are looking at it too. You're right in terms of the monetization of it. When does it get to a point where a fan says, I don't want that season ticket because I can have that experience at home? We're ways away from that. Ways away from that. Because ultimately, the way it is shot is different. It's not inexpensive. And the biggest hurdle that they have is those darn goggles. I was a part of the launch of 3D at ESPN, which no longer exists. Everybody was rushing to get TVs, 3D TVs. Not anymore. And part of the issue was, I had to wear these darn glasses. It wasn't as much of a social experience. So I think we've got a long way to go before it's about watching a live game from your house in virtual reality. But I think you're going to see a ton of virtual reality content that people are going to try to monetize that you can watch in your home or elsewhere. That's definitely taking place. Got to be more. I was either that bad or that good.